Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the first edition of SPAG Dialogue, a series of online events brought to you by PR and advocacy experts, SPAG, in association with Reputation Today. A warm welcome to all our panelists and the 130 plus registered participants who have logged in today using Zoom. This session is also being live streamed on YouTube on our channel bit.ly Reputation Today on YT. So if you're facing any issues with Zoom, you may switch to YouTube without the option of asking questions, of course. For those who are attending using Zoom, please feel free to ask your questions using the Q&A box. Please avoid using the chat box for this. Before we introduce our panelists, let me remind you the hashtag for today is Policy Dialogue. That's hashtag Policy Dialogue. Please tweet your learnings, thoughts, and ideas about this series using the hashtag Policy Dialogue. And don't forget to tag SPAG Asia and Rep Today Mag. I would now like to welcome our panelists for today, Berges Malu, Director for Public Policy and Policy Communications at ShareChat, Govindraj Ethiraj, Founder IndiaSpend and Boom, Paroma Roy Chowdhury, Senior Director Asia Communications and Public Affairs at SoftBank Group International, and Sanjay Khan, Partner at Khaitan & Company. And moderating the panel discussion today is Aman Gupta, co-founder and managing partner at SPAG. Over to you, Aman, to steer this conversation ahead.
Thank you, Anubhuti, and thank you everyone for joining in, both my esteemed panel and everybody who's attending this through different channels which we have today. This is the first of this kind of a session which we are having under this policy dialogue, and over the couple of months, we hope to have a few more of this. Let me start by sort of using a phrase, I think, which has become quite a common theme amongst the conversation which happens, the new world order. You know, any conversation which we have, whether with the clients or within the corporate world, a new world order starts to sort of emerge as a conversational theme. And I think it has reached a stage where it's almost established itself as the way the world would shape up in the coming future. Apart from the new world order, the one more terminology which has started to emerge is something called infodemiology. I got to know about this terminology just last month when WHO did first of its global meet on this particular subject. The idea was to look at how infodemics affect the world and how they can be managed. We do believe that infodemic has reached a level where it needs a coordinated and a continuous response. And the way a news, a disinformation or misinformation is kind of now looking like a virus which spreads among the humans, like the way it spreads through digital or physical information systems. And there is a call now for having a kind of a multi-stakeholder approach to really see how we could possibly adapt, develop, validate, and evaluate an evidence-based measures to really look at mitigating the issues which may arise from something like this. The idea of today's conversation on this policy dialogue is to really seek views from our esteemed panelists on the subject and really move from a larger conversation to in terms of what could be really done in a policy space if you want to sort of really make a dent in this particular arena. Therefore, without further getting into the introduction of the subject, let me start from Govind. Govind, you have been kind of at the forefront of really trying to look at the fake news and how to do fact checks and all. What has really happened in the recent past? You know, this pandemic has created an epidemic. Why such a huge surge? That it needed a kind of a global, a meeting led by WHO, and why something like this is such a serious issue right now? And, what can you really tell us on this subject?
Thanks, Aman. Thanks, everyone from SPAG for inviting me for this panel discussion. So let me give you a broad sense. So firstly, you have to understand that misinformation is a military industrial complex. It's not as random as, two people who stumble upon something, send it to two friends, and they in turn send it to people, and it reaches a million people by the end of the week. That also happens, but that's not really the problem as we now know it or as we are trying to fight it. The second thing is that it spreads faster only as your let's say that your smartphone or your internet penetration increases. So in India, for instance, we all know that the smartphone penetration and connectivity has gone up dramatically in the last 3 or 4 years. And in India, again, smartphone equals internet equals WhatsApp. So the dissemination and the speed of dissemination is therefore very dramatic and much higher than maybe most other countries in the world. And of course, when you have close to 500 million people with smartphones, you're talking about a completely different scale of information flow, whether it's misinformation or genuine information. I think the larger problem is what does all of this do? I think it does three or four things. I think it has done and is doing is to affect us mentally. It affects us physically, and I'll give you an example of physical. 2 years ago, more than 30 people died in India because of rumors on WhatsApp about child kidnappers. And India is the only country where rumors on and misinformation converts to violence in a way that's quite deadly, which I don't think there are any cataloged incidents like this, at least at this scale, anywhere else in the world. So it affects us physically. Third is it brings down and continues to accelerate in some ways or accentuate the reduction of trust in the entire ecosystem. So, and you know, I mean, you must be all familiar with the Edelman Trust Barometer, which looks at media, looks at government, NGOs, and so on. And you can see that government has been falling, NGOs is steady, business is higher, and media, of course, continues to fall. The problem with misinformation, which the Edelman Trust Barometer also looks at and talks about a substantial amount of respondents talk about this being as a problem and being used as a weapon, is also that it's destroying or eroding the very nature of communication and brand communication. So what I'm submitting here is that over time, your ability to tell people anything about anything or convey a message or send a message or sell a brand attribute or a product or a service is going to get diminished because the overall trust in the ecosystem of information is falling, and it's falling because of misinformation, right? So now if you take any product or service, you will find that at some point of time, it's been a victim of misinformation. So one is that, let's say if you take a Maggi or a Nestle Maggi, something happened, it was big, but it recovered over time, right? But there was damage. There are many more examples, let's say an Ashirwad Atta, Combi Flam, brands have lost large chunks of sales because there has been such a high degree of suspicion about the product or service. And this is purely fake news. There are other times where maybe there is some element of truth in it and the brand. So what happens? Over time, when you constantly keep hearing about, let's say, you see a video about this guy who is eating food that was supposed to be delivered by a food aggregator company, or you see some message key which keeps coming that, you know, click on this and you'll get a free two-wheeler or a ticket on an Emirates so on. So over time, your ability to believe in a true message will reduce and is reducing, I would argue. So to me, that is something that we have to be very careful of, and you have to therefore work harder. So maybe 10 years ago, you could say that I'm launching this new cream, face cream, which is going to, you know, make you shine 25% more with at 10% less cost and all that. And it'll largely be believed because it's a traditional brand, well-known brand, respected and all that. But that's now going to change. That's changing now across the spectrum. I mean, there is no single this thing. The final bit, the part is that what do we do? And I'm going to pause after that, and I'll quote a quick study that we've done as well. We have to address this at two levels. One is we have to fight and fight hard. There is no solution or substitute. You know, I think many people thought that they could take the Gandhian way out and say that, okay, I'm going to do my bit. I'm going to focus on delivering a good product and service, and eventually people will accept, no, etc. The chances of that working are reducing. I'm not saying it doesn't work. Of course it works, but word of mouth will help and so on. But you're up against a machinery. Remember that. It's not a few disgruntled customers who may or may not be rightfully, pulling you down. The second thing is that we have to educate. Education is something that everyone has to invest in, and have to invest across the board. You have to invest in educating young people, children, about misinformation, about the internet itself, how to make the internet safer. A lot of what we consume, even if it's accurate, is not something that we are geared to consume. You may see medical sites like a WebMD and look at it and say, oh, I've got a catch in my shoulder, and what do I do? And you go there and you'll find seven answers for seven possible reasons, ranging from sprain to bone marrow cancer or something as dramatic as that. And that comes up precisely because many people have searched or found that link, and that's how search works. So, but the point is that that's not inaccurate, but you're not geared to study it, and you're not geared to interpret it. And only maybe you can inform yourself, but a decision on that should be taken by your general physician and no one else. But that's something that I think COVID overall you're fighting, because there is so much misinformation around it. Just to give you a quick this thing and then I'll close. We did a study of fact checks that we did between Jan and May, about 178 coronavirus fact checks. And we found that while the initial fact checks were about coronavirus, as the days passed, as we went into April and May, a lot of the fact checks actually became about targeting a religious community, which was blamed for spreading coronavirus. So, whether it was deliberate or not, I'm not going to get into that here, but it was clear that even that was, manipulated. So towards the end, or at least towards the end of May, fact checks were not so much about coronavirus, but about how some people were spreading coronavirus. And that became very large. Okay, I'm not talking about small numbers. So we did another study of about 174 fact checks in the subsequent month, which is June and July. And we found the one thing we found is, so this is the time period that we've seen the Sushant Singh Rajput and all these kind of stories come up, that the fake news machinery shifts with amazing speed and alacrity. So they wait and jump onto events, onto whether it's, events like an unfortunate suicide, or it might be, let's say, a conflagration at a border. It might be something else. But the machinery jumps onto it, and that machinery may include formal, informal, and others who clamber on, but it jumps on and capitalizes and then starts, repurposing and pushing. So just to sum up that what we're dealing with, and when you study it in retrospect, you'll find some fairly, fairly frightening trends that we all, whether we are in business, media, public service, government, public policy, we all have to be very mindful of. So I'll pause there. Thank you.
Thanks, Govindan. And I think, you did sort of kind of echoed the fact that this is an issue which is no longer confined to a small group, or it's something which only should be sort of considered by a specific set of stakeholders. It's something which, as you rightly said, it's kind of eroding the basic value or respect or trust. And when the trust starts to get lost, it has its economic impact from a brand or a business side of it, but also it can have an impact, when the community starts to not have a trust among themselves, and therefore it has its own, social culture or communal, community-based aspects to it. And specifically when you have a crisis happening in an outside world, what you really need is a kind of a trust, and something like this really needs to be fought hard, fought right now. Yes, I think education amongst different stakeholders, trying to bring in a behavioral change to sort of say that, people sort of think before they act on any information which comes in front of them, is one of the things which has been, been discussed. I think this is, for me, is a good way for, bringing in Berges, you to sort of, you represent, ShareChat, and from a platform perspective, and, from your perspective, how do you think, what is the role which the companies could do? Is there a certain aspect of intervention which could be done to mitigate such kind of an information flow? How do you can play a role of the technology? Is there a technology which can play a role in trying to mitigate something like this, which is there? So, if you can sort of share some of your thoughts, how you guys doing it, and what could be the possible future, what may look like, and is there a way of reducing this huge erosion of trust which is happening because of this misinformation and rumors?
Right, Aman. First off, I now not only represent ShareChat, but also another platform, which is Moj. But I think primarily the fact that there is so much fake news is also a one of the causes of this is the fact that there is a vacuum of information. So if you look at COVID also, you know, you'll see a lot of people want to know a cure. So if anything, anyone suggests this is a new cure for it, people want to widely share it. And I'm sure Govind sees a lot of new inventions, a lot of new cures that come up every day, both on our platform, because he's folks fact check content on our platform and elsewhere. What we as platforms are doing, and at least I can speak for ShareChat, is that a lot of such content is, when it's reported by our users, we send it across to fact checkers. We have fact checkers looking at content in 13 languages on the platform now. And if content is found to be factually inaccurate, we reduce its reach. We try and not allow users to see it. So we put an interstitial on it and give users the actual facts about what is happening. But beyond this, really, it's also, I think, a point where the government needs to come out with new regulations and new laws that ensure that people are fearful of sharing such content. Today, the fact is that if you share such content, there's really not much of a penal provision that can be applied against you for doing this. And in most cases, this is, it's people do it for fun. But a lot of instances have led to real-world harm, like Govind actually mentioned. People have died because of fake news spreading on WhatsApp and other platforms. And so taking the blame, putting the blame on platforms is very difficult. It's while there are some platforms that, look at censoring content and trying to ensure that their platform only has content that their political bosses prefer, in an open democracy like India, you cannot be controlling speech on the platform. So the only way to actually do this is to have better policies around this.
Thanks, Berges. I think, you brought in a perspective from a government, the role of the government, the law, regulation, and the policy side of it. I still want to sort of stick with you for another 1 minute to just sort of understand, because it is a technology platform, and as a part of the larger way the technology is evolving, do you think the future technology, specifically from a machine learning or from an AI, there could be mechanisms to sometimes filter out certain information which is construed as misinformation, and also I think last year we had somebody from Boom visiting our office, and he talked about the fact that certain information comes back. So something which was recognized as factually incorrect 4 years back, but then it makes a comeback after 4 years. So there is to be a kind of a mechanism to sort of say, okay, there was, I know, where if something which was already in this ecosystem, if it comes back, it should not be further spreading. So do you think that kind of a technology innovation and investment in that is something which needs to be brought in by the platform, so that the platform remains a source of right information for the people, and they're able to freely enjoy, and they're able to sort of engage on that, these on platforms like yours?
Right. No, I think there are fundamental problems with this suggestion. There are platforms from China that have employed these AI tools, and it essentially builds, makes your platform into some sort of censorship-driven dystopia. And then you'll have, and it's, frankly, some of these platforms have been banned in India. But going down this route is very problematic. You cannot enforce, as a platform, I do not want to judge what is right or wrong. I'd rather have a third-party fact-checker like Govind, take a call on what is factually accurate or not accurate. When you start employing things like AI tools on this, you also run the risk of, let's say, Govind is now putting up a story over there talking about something that has been reported to be untrue. And my AI tool, looks at that image, realizes that, okay, this was factually inaccurate, and takes down Govind's post. I don't think that's the intention here, right? And so a lot of times, things like this, it's very easy to say that, you can use AI, you can use technology to fight this. But that's a very difficult path to go down. And once you start doing that, it builds on, largely censoring your platform. The better mechanism to do this is, one, is to ensure that there's more, factual information going out from your newspapers, for instance. A lot of times you'll see, newspapers are carrying news that is not particularly true. you want to ensure that the government is putting out more factual information. I mean, when the COVID situation had just begun in India, there was a government release that said, you know, Ayurveda can cure COVID. And that's where you actually start then seeing a lot of this other information popping up saying, you know, snort sesame oil and it may actually help you fight COVID. If the government is pushing that kind of stuff out, if the newspapers are pushing that kind of stuff out, you can't fight fake news with you know, technology. Fake news has been there since the time of Mahabharata. The only way to actually fight it is to have more, you know, actual news out there, to have more folks like Govindraj, you know, better empowered to fight this rather than saying employ AI tools. If you start employing AI tools, the next thing you know, we are living in a country like China where half the information is taken down because the platform's boss doesn't like it. And I don't think that's something that India should ever aspire to.
That sounds good, but then I think that's a very, very fair point. And I think it also sort of gets me, you know, to start with Paroma because, you know, one of the points which she raised yesterday when we were having our earlier conversation was the need for a credible information. So I think it's extending Berges your point that people have the need for information, right? And they need, and that need exists. So therefore, if anything which is sort of out there, they would like to, you know, pick it up. But a aspect which comes in terms of where is the credible information coming from and what are those platforms which are there and what are the kind of checks and balances which could be brought in. And I think, you know, they're the, and therefore we wanted, as I said in the beginning, policy can play a kind of a role. So, but I think, you know, from your perspective as a communication and as a, you know, public affairs expert who has sort of seen the world, how do you see something like this emerging and what could be the next phase of ensuring that the information which is out there, we are able to mitigate. I don't think it can go away completely, but we can mitigate such kind of a misinformation which are there and ensure that the society gets the right and credible information.
Thanks, Aman. Thanks, Reputation Today, for having me here. So I take it at three levels, and I'm speaking largely as a consumer of information here because we have many, many experts on the other side. So first is the most important, which is a credible data source. If I am a company, I'm an organization, or as an individual, looking for some information for my own use or my use of my company or my colleagues or a team of internal experts, I would look at credible data sources. And you know, it is really up to newspapers, portals, and anyone who's a provider of information to be credible. That is, I mean, the intent to be that, and B, the wherewithal to be that. Because, you know, as two earlier panelists have said, there's a lot of deliberate misinformation is also put out in the external domain by a variety of players. And sometimes you wouldn't even believe that, you know, such information can come from such a source. But it has happened. I mean, without naming individuals or organizations, we all know that happens. So I think the onus is very much on editors of print publications, television, digital news sources to be as credible and as factual as possible. These platforms are not meant for editorializing the information. I really, really want to underline that. For opinion pieces, there are places. And like an edit page or an op-ed page, and it's similar places in the digital world. Your job is first and foremost as a news portal is to put out credible information. The intent needs to be there and the tools need to be there. And people like Govind or Pratik Sinha of Alt News play a very, very important role here for checking. The second thing I would say for the providers of information, it's very important to package it right as well. Because, you know, I get a plethora of information from a variety of sources every morning. So how do I choose? Who do I trust? How do I look at? So if I have 10 minutes to look at it, or my CEO has 10 minutes or 5 minutes to do, like have a quick recap, is there a way I can package the information to be more useful? I was recently talking to a very qualified bunch of guys who want to start a service like this. And they're saying, you know, we want to send videos. I said, it's okay. It's a very tactical example. I said, it's fantastic. I mean, if you have five links and a 2-minute video, that could be a really good capsule. I could watch it in the car. But please don't expect that somebody will trawl through 20 links to get to the news or get to what you want. So A, the credible data source is very important. Don't editorialize. Please provide factual information and please do fact checking. Second is package it right, package it in small bites, package in how it works, make it attractive, but don't make it spurious. So the packaging is no one thinks about this too much, but it's very, very right. It has to be, I have to be compelled to look at it, right? In the morning, whether on a device or mostly we consume information on devices now. So whatever is device friendly. The third thing is, I completely agree with my earlier panelist, censorship is a very, very slippery slope and regulation of any kind, because you never know where it's going to stop. And, you know, and it's just falling down a rabbit hole. So yes, I mean, I feel very strongly about this also given my Google experience. So any attempt to regulate through government intervention is not an ideal state. So there, I think responsible players, responsible platforms are the same thing. And you can't make, I mean, I'm not going to go into legalities. Sanjay can do that. We can't make platforms responsible for content. We absolutely can't. So, you know, it's up to all of us to be responsible, to have good intent, and do things which, and it all seems utopian, but I think really a concerted effort is needed by players, by government, by civil society to arrive or to combat this. And to your point on tools like AI, etc., they can be very good. Google employs that. Facebook has a lot of content moderation folks, as you know, everybody does, YouTube. But the numbers are mind-boggling. Just go look up Facebook stats or YouTube stats and you will know what I'm talking about in Twitter. It's not humanly possible to regulate all that through human eyes. But at the same time, if you employ too much of tools like AI and monitoring, I mean, you do run the risk of the content getting censored right at the start. So I think it's going to be a combination of policy, tools, good intent, to arrive at this, I mean, you know, some kind of a solution, and but we have to keep working at it. That's a long answer, I'm sorry, but that's what I feel. And I do feel very strongly about this.
No, thanks, Paroma. And I think it's a subject which does need, it's not a simple issue. So a complex issue which does need a more nuanced approach to it. It's not like a one tool which will be able to take care of whole thing. But I think it brings, Sanjay, to you, because both Paroma talked about and, you know, Berges talked about the role from a law and regulation and from a policy side of it. Berges said that's one area which should definitely exist, because the people who are creating content right now, which may be misinformation, there is no law or regulation to sort of say that this is something which they should not do, or there's no kind of a, you know, kind of a legal penalty around it. And Paroma also said that, you know, while that may not be the only tool, but it is a tool which needs to be considered from a policy side, you know, what is the kind of regulations which exist. So Sanjay, from your perspective, you know, how do you see something like this evolving? It's not a simple thing. There has to be a balance between the democratic way, freedom of speech, but still ensuring that does not reach to a level where that speech is eroding the basic foundation of the society.
Thanks. I'll try and keep it short. Pause me wherever you think I'm going over time. Like you said, and everybody else alluded to, it's not an easy problem. For audience, I particularly want to mention, it is not a topic that we can find any sort of solution to in a discussion like this for an hour, but it is a good initiative that we are discussing this so that thoughts and ideas come about. On whether there are policies or regulations in place or not, I don't think we are dealing with something which is new. It's an irony that we've all heard of the quote that a lie travels half the world while the truth is putting on its shoe. And it's incorrectly attributed to Mark Twain, all along, whereas Mark Twain died before it is attributed to the time. So it is a very old problem. Our IPC is a more than 150 year old legislation. It deals with a lot of these aspects. If you, with any intent, start something which is fake and you're disseminating in public, and there is intent behind it which can be proven, then there are ample provisions in the IPC. I won't go into them, but there, we have all seen them. We have seen those provisions being used, misused, and underused also, right? I think, and therefore, I don't believe that the debate is about getting a new law, a new authority, etc. I think as a society, we have a problem of not checking something before we pass it on. I think it's a societal problem also, and that it also goes to our data privacy concerns in India, whether we don't feel hesitant in asking somebody about their personal lives. We don't feel hesitant about passing on something which may be personal and which may be correct, incorrect, whatever. Therefore, I think it is a personality issue. It is a habitual issue that needs to be solved at a larger societal level. How do we do it? In essence, any bad behavior that you want to correct, how do you solve for it? If bad behavior is resulting in a deep loss to society at large, if it's a in rem sort of an action that you need to take, there is criminal penalty for it. If it is harming a particular individual or a company, then you penalize that by way of some monetary penalty. I think both of them in separate domains exist today. We need to enforce it. Unfortunately, our enforcement mechanism is also, and I wouldn't blame them for it. It's just that we don't have enough resources at our hand. Our cyber branches of various police stations across India, they have been issuing notices. We deal with those notices for our clients on various aspects. Now, the same authority, same cyber branch is issuing notices for a fraud, an online fraud, a bad content, or a content which is used in mischievous ways, etc. Now, if we can have more hands there, I'm sure they can penalize more people and look into more actions. So in summary, what I'm trying to say is that it has to flow top down. If I can take an example of, say, how RBI regulates the financial market. RBI has first set of regulation for banks, then for NBFCs, then for people below them, etc., etc. And finally, for individuals, right? When you remit money from India to abroad, you as an individual need to. A similar approach should be followed, because it's impossible to regulate individuals upfront, because our police, who is the main authority to go after individuals, is not equipped. So who do you go after? You first ensure that media houses, large newspapers, we have the Press Council of India. There is another debate as to whether Press Council of India can enforce everything very, very stringently or not. But maybe that is one area to look at. So because if media houses are fearful that if I publish something without checking, then there is a sword hanging on my neck, then the first level of check will come there. Today, what happens is somebody picks up a Twitter thing or anywhere else and would put it up as a news article and later on correct, maybe a week later. But between that, a lot of it happens. So I think it should be a top-down approach. We should have enforcement of our existing regulations. I don't think we need to really reinvent the wheel and come up with a new set of regulations authority. If we can just enhance the enforcement today itself, I think we can see a huge difference.
Thanks, Sanjay. That's really, really interesting. And I think it's, moves to the sort of next layer, which I was thinking in terms of what shall be the way forward. And I think you have provided a perspective, but let me come to Govind now. So Govind, you've been both from a fact check, plus you've been with the media. So what Sanjay was talking about in terms of kind of a top-down approach. So I think there is one, which is a kind of a self-regulation, responsibilism, education. I think those things need to exist. And I think there has to be a way to invest behind that kind of thing. Now, whether the different players come together to launch an industry-wide campaign or what needs to be done. So I think the education and behavior change is one, but from a regulation side, to have like a central body which can do like a top-down thing, where there's also not just policy, but also enforcement. Do you think there's something like this is a possibility, and what could be the possible contours of this?
No, I think any regulation or any such response to information flows is very, very tricky territory. And I think that's been articulated by Paroma, Berges and Sanjay in different ways. So, and it really goes to the fundamental of what we are as a country and or what we want to be. So, there is a problem. I mean, we cannot deny that. There is a magnification of that problem because of technology, and we cannot deny that as well. But that's the supply side. On the demand side, it goes back to why do you and I believe what we believe when we see right. it? And whether it comes from my uncle in the morning or a friend or whoever it is. So I think you have to address these issues both on the demand side as well as on the supply side. The demand side I already talked about, and the supply side said that, listen, you need to get much more stronger. Now, stronger and firmer, and because it is a battle right now, or it is a war, depending on how you see it. There is self-regulation, however, which needs to come into play when it comes to, let's say, media, for instance. I think it's very clear in some cases that, you know, so media makes mistakes. I mean, I've been a financial journalist almost all my life. And I mean, I've made my fair share of mistakes in the past. Others have made it and all that. But I think I know now, and most people do, what is a mistake and what is not, and what is deliberately being twisted. You know, you do some poll and then you find that someone clearly, it's a 30% has said yes, whereas 70% has said no, but the graphic looks the other way around. You know, and on a leading TV news network. And there's no way that's a mistake, because people don't make mistakes like that.
Exactly.
You know, and so I think but what happens when something like that happens? Is there any self-regulation within the body? Is it whether it's the Press Council of India or the News Broadcasters Association? No. At this point, I mean, nothing that I have ever seen of any significance. So I think the self, but that does not mean that we should not do it or should not press for it. I think within media, there has to be self-regulation. But you have to also remember that the problem of misinformation, as we are discussing it today, 98% of it lies beyond media. As in, media is not the primary disseminator. Many people hate media and would like to think that media is the thing, but it's not. You know, this all happens in the sort of 98% subterranean networks, so to speak, which includes your WhatsApp or Signal or Telegram inbox or whatever it is. So I think self-regulation at a media level, but I think, and we've not done much of that, a sense that, you know, there has to be some, that you have to be worried that if you do something deliberately, then what can happen? Different countries have approached this differently. Sanjay may be able to throw more light. I mean, Germany, for instance, puts more onus on the platform. Other countries put less onus on the platform. In India, it's very likely that if I post something unfavorable against, let's say, a political leader, I can the same evening get hauled and hauled into police station on fairly flimsy charges and remain there for a while. So, and that's happened as well. So, yeah, I think we are in a strange position, but I would definitely argue for more self-regulation. I would argue for more education and training. But equally, I think I would argue that people have to have a right to say what they wish. And I think freedom of speech without it becoming sedition every time is very critical. You know, I mean, we are a democracy. We should be allowed to express our opinions on things. And I mean, we tend to cross that line very often nowadays.
Sounds good. No, Govindraj, I think there is kind of a consensus on that side. But coming to the part two, so self-regulation, I think there is one part of it. The second is in terms of sensitization, education of the larger masses, you know, or the consumer, you know, consumption of where it happens, and for them to know, you know, what is, you know, how can they basically be more conscious about before sort of sending something out. So, but just from a platform perspective, do you think there is a possibility, or there is a need for the different platforms to come together, maybe as a cohesive group, to run such a kind of a campaign, which could be, you know, good for the larger community as well as for the platforms itself? Do you think that's a decent ask, or is there something which has to come from some pillar sales?
I think platforms coming together to apply fabric conditioner on such issues and absolve themselves is problematic, because one is that different platforms, you know, focus on these issues differently. Just because, you know, bringing all of them together and trying to make them all seem as bad or as good is not going to work. You have one platform that censors LGBTQ content. and then you want to partner with that same platform to try and do something else is kind of ridiculous. So I don't think platforms coming together is a great idea.
Mm-hmm.
So even in the US right now, you know, there's one platform that's saying we're going to take strict action on political speech. If it's, you know, if it's fake news, we'll call it out. And then there's another platform that says, hey, if it's political speech, I don't care. You know, even if it's fake news, it can go we don't care. So you can't have platforms coming together because each platform has a different view on these issues. And so in from that perspective, I think every platform is doing what they think is best. And it may actually make more sense if a third party body or, you know, someone like the IFCN comes out and says, hey, these are the things that, you know, platforms need to do, or this is the gold standard, rather than, you know, putting the onus on platforms. And the fact is that there are some platforms that prefer to fight fake news, and there are some platforms that actually find monetizing fake news is far better and more profitable. And I'm sure Govind is aware of what I'm trying to refer to. So it's not easy to say that platforms need to come together and fight this. I don't think that's ever going to happen. Different platforms have different ways at looking at this issue, and I don't think we are all on the same page.
Yeah, but I think the only thing I would add to that, Aman, very quickly, is that, see, there is public service messaging that is important in these areas. You know, traditionally, a government, for instance, could say that I will invest more in public service broadcasting or high quality public service broadcasting. And we have a public service broadcaster to create a counter in a way to all this content that you're seeing around you, which is obviously not of a good let's say, level or something that can educate. So you may not ask the platform, but you could say, OK, all platforms have to contribute some time and effort to something that becomes a national effort. We've seen it in healthcare, for instance, right? Or let's say in financial services, all mutual funds contribute to a fund, and that becomes the Association of Mutual Fund of India, which furthers the cause of investor education in India. So maybe something like that. I mean, that's just a thought.
Fair enough, Govind. I think that's a possibility. And I think, Berges, I do understand where you're coming from with it, you know, and I do follow what's happening in the US or in other places, and the differing views which appear on different kind of information which floats on different platforms. But Paroma, coming back to you, you know, you did talk about sort of a, you know, three parts. There is a tools, there is a self-regulation, and there is a policy side of it. Now, if, from your perspective as an, and again, as you said, you know, as a consumer of the information, do you think there is a policy ecosystem which could possibly be a balance between the supply and the demand side? And if you think there is a possibility, what could that possibly look like?
Again, I will break it up into three parts. One is, of course, I agree with everybody that there needs to be a lot more sensitization. And we have a role, all of us will have a role to play in that education and sensitization of the civil society and consumers. This incredible behavior that prompts us to throw out every little scrap of information we receive without checking its source, it's really dangerous, and people take full advantage of it. So please teach, educate, sensitize whenever you can. That's one part. The second part is, I think that, you know, coming together of platforms, etc., great that it may sound, it doesn't quite work like that. And also bringing in more regulations, we have already talked about it, it's not a great idea. However, I think in the policy ecosystem, one thing that can be looked at in the policy legal ecosystem is, drawing on my experience in Google, mm-hmm. that content removal and content regulation processes are very, very complex and lengthy. Without going into details of MLAT, et cetera, the process itself, particularly when you are dealing with multinational giants, it's fairly onerous and complex. So if some of it can be made simpler, I'm not saying that you bring back regulation, but I'm just saying that, you know, if processes around those things, content removal, flagging of content, removing of content, can be made a little easier, if you don't have to get a police complaint every time, a court order every time, though there are tremendous benefits of that also. It prevents arbitrariness. But, you know, that those processes can be perhaps looked at and made a little simpler for people to act on things swiftly. But at the same time, I mean, there is, when there is grave provocation, what do you do? I mean, when, you know, we got calls like, you have to pull this video down from YouTube because in 2 hours, there is a prayer meeting on a Friday and we think there's going to be violence. Or there is a kid, two people are getting lynched to death because people think that they're kidnappers. So we all need to think, I mean, these are very, very serious issues. It's much bigger than say a question, say a Ramdev or anyone. These are actual genuine law and order issues which are unfolding and resulting in death and violence. So, you know, really we need to have more dialogue, more transparency of processes, more sitting down and to arrive at things, mechanisms together. It doesn't happen. My experience of being in the policy and comms domain for a long time, there's not enough, you know, solidarity amongst ourselves, in the want of a better word. So I would say two things as actionables. One is looking at simplifying those processes of removal and flagging. And the second is either having a third party body or some mechanism of people coming together and deciding and implementing.
Thanks, Paroma. I think, you know, I'm conscious of the time also, and the fact that we already have pretty decent number of questions coming our way. And I think that would further, you know, build up on this particular conversation. But sort of kind of summarizing, I think all of us do agree that it's not a kind of a simple subject. It's complex. It has a kind of a multiple legs and would need a very different, innovative, unique way to see how we could possibly, as I always say, you know, mitigate the situations which may arise. And I think it might need all of us, you know, different people to come together, have a dialogue and find maybe a certain common, you know, grounds on which needs to sort of things needs to happen. So with that, I think let me, you know, sort of pause here and, you know, look at some of the questions which have come our way. Fortunately or unfortunately, nobody has sort of said that who the questions are referred to. So therefore, it's gonna be up to us to decide who wants to, you know, sort of do. So coming to the, you know, let me start with the, you know, the first question which we have from Annabel D'Souza, and what the question is: do brands understand the dangers of internet penetration? Because advertising dollars are increasing on digital, citing growing internet penetration. So I think, any of you who wants to take this particular question in terms of the perils of internet penetration, or is this something which is happening? So, you know, do the brands understand what it really could possibly mean, both positive and negative? So, Berges, can I sort of pass it on to you as a from a first to answer this question, because, you know, the brands do partner with your platform. So, what's your view on this particular perspective?
It's a very tough question to answer as a platform. I think as Paroma is better suited as a brand that has QR codes. We have our own platform, so we can control the information. But
so Paroma, your expertise is being called for.
No, I think I've spoken enough. Somehow somebody else should take it.
But I think the fact is that yes, I think I go back to what I say about the fact that there is a information vacuum. So for instance, a couple of months ago before the pandemic struck, there was a case in Kerala where a very big FMCG brand, their biscuits were, there was this fake news going around that their biscuits had pork fat in it. And immediately, you know, the brand, one of the things that the brand had to do was spend more marketing money to push this notion away. Obviously, they had to go to court to get a court order to take down this content, all of that. But in the, you know, when there is a lack of information about certain things in certain brands, it leads to more fake news. So sometimes, you know, it's actually the inverse, that brands, I think, understand that digital penetration would mean that if their voice is not heard over there, it can be problematic for them. So I think that's the inverse of what Annabelle is suggesting. But open to others, I think Paroma may have.
No, I have just one thing to add, that for as brands or as organizations who are getting targeted, swift rebuttal is very necessary. You know, you don't have the luxury of sitting and deliberating on it. Just go act immediately. This I speak from experience and enough examples around. Govind can vouch for it from his media days.
I'm still in media.
He's still in media. The
fact is, it's very funny that you would assume that newspapers are supposed to tell us give us the facts, but in fact, you have now fact checkers who fact check the media, who then tell us what is true or not true. So, I guess newspapers don't actually now give us the truth anymore.
Well, I think that sort of brings us to the next.
Legal action is also important, because in a lot of cases nowadays, you can get a injunction order immediately, and people at times wait for it, etc. If you can get an injunction order the next day or very same day in some cases, you can just publicize that order, and that can save a lot.
Immediately. And I mean, swiftness is very important in acting.
Perfect. Sounds good. I think it's kind of an extension of the previous, but not what we were discussing from a regulation perspective in media. The question we have from Vartika, what she's asking is, recently we saw Ramdev spreading disinformation about his vaccine, but I think it would be about the cure for corona, in compliance with the media, especially TV, which played a key role in endorsing it without any fact checking. How does one to cater media's tacit compliance in spreading infodemic? So again, an open question. So who wants to take it? Govind, do you want to sort of take this one?
I don't want to like defend anyone and so on, but I mean, clearly people should have paid more attention to what was being broadcast. So I think a lot of TV networks usually take cover under the statement that or the claim that, you know, this it's all happening and therefore I don't have time to check and fact check and, you know, I'm just reporting it as it is and all of that. I think maybe that worked at one point of time. It doesn't. If anyone had, looked carefully at anyone, I'm just saying, even if you were an intern, out of college or even still in college, you would have known that to make a claim on the basis of something like a cure for COVID, which does not exist on planet Earth, is something very fantastic and should have been questioned. So I think whether it's whoever did it, I mean, I think they should have clearly contextualized it. You know, for instance, maybe you're broadcasting that press conference live and saying, okay, here is this, this is a cure, this is not. I mean, they've actually backtracked subsequently, but you know, so you could always say that, the anchor could contextualize, the graphics could contextualize, saying that there is no known cure and this is a claim, you know. So even if you just put claim optically it would have appeared that, okay, you're not necessarily
endorsing it,
supporting it or whatever. But I mean, what more do you say? I mean, this is, it's too crystal clear a case of where there was not enough homework
If I can jump in here, I don't know if some of you noticed, but there was a TV channel that listed out the names, or supposedly the names of some army officers from China who were killed in battle. And then it turned out to be that those names were a message on a WhatsApp forward, right? And this was on national television, on one of the most watched national television channels. So I think it's also this hunger to be there and be there before anyone else can report it. It doesn't matter whether what we are saying is true or not true, because if it's not true, in the next slot, we will not repeat this video if it gets fact-checked or we realize it's a mistake, but we'll play it nevertheless. And I'm sure Govind, being a television journalist at one point, may have some more insights on this, but I think the fact. It's just that people want to put it out there. You just want to share it.
No, you do. I mean, I agree. I mean, the pressures of real-time television and weekly TRPs, which in turn drive all the content and all the problems that we talk about. I mean, that's common for everyone. But I think there is huge danger here when you're telling someone that, you know, there is a cure for COVID, and you're causing two things. One is people stop maybe doing other things and say, okay, I can stop wearing a mask, I can stop social distancing because I'm going to take this medicine and all my problems are gone, you know. So, I mean, you're damaging and of course, you're creating a false scenario where there is actually no cure and you're creating a sense, and therefore you don't take any other medicine, which might make you more immune or whatever. So, this is a public health attack. I mean, this is not just a WhatsApp message, which has other implications. But I think in the health space, you're really causing damage.
And on the lighter side.
To be fair, one of the TV channels, a very, very well-known national one, and I'm going to name it because it's a positive story, TV Today took Ramdev to the cleaners, basically. You know, I've seen that in like episode after episode by different anchors, and why he chose to appear for all of them, I mean, unfathomable. But they did a really good job of pulling this the wool out.
But on the
sometimes
on the other
it
side.
Does work. Sometimes it does work. That's what I'm saying.
On the other side, the other fact is that right after the lockdown started, there was this news that an earthquake would strike Delhi, and all the fact checkers said it wouldn't. And now we have seen how many earthquakes have happened in Delhi. So I don't know if the fact checkers are also, you know, doing their job correctly, because they said there's no such news. And now we've seen one every week. So who's going to fact check the fact checkers?
So we need a fact checker for the fact checkers. So it's going to be a pretty long stream. But Sanjay, from something like this, from a legal perspective, is there kind of a, you know, when you have a something like this, and looking from what Govind said, it's a public health issue, right? Where you have, where millions could get suffer, or, you know, because this is okay, you know, we're going to have this thing and I will stop taking any precautions, you know, no mask, you know, no social distancing. So you're not just causing harm to yourself, but you're causing harm to the people otherwise. For something like this, what's the kind of a regulatory or a legal
ecosystem? Any bad behavior, state action or action of authorities is very, very important. Bad behavior will not go off on its own. Like we have seen in multiple cases. If I can draw another parallel, look at insider trading regulations in India. Insider trading is habitually all people within a deal framework would talk to each other, etc. That has been a cultural sort of upbringing in the financial space. But come 1990s, there is a increased sort of focus on regulatory action against insider trading. And today everybody is quite aware that, look, if I engage in something like this, there will be an action. Unless there is that action taken in a couple of cases like the ones we have seen in securities market, if similar actions are taken here, only then people will realize that yes, something can actually go wrong if I broadcast this particular thing or if I pass on this message. You know, in one of the cases I saw recently, I think it was during Corona itself, there was one fake sort of forward doing the rounds that if you forward any message in this thing, then people are getting arrested, etc. And that actually resulted in lesser search messages doing the rounds on WhatsApp. People were relying on another fake sort of forward to get a bit fearful about not forwarding other messages. So I think that fear of posting anything wrong will come only when there is some action taken. And like we have discussed, we need some authority, either existing ones or a new authority looking at it and imposing certain, be it self-regulatory authority or a mandatory one.
Thanks, Sanjay. I think we're almost going to be at the end of the thing. So I'm going to ask one last question, and specifically Paroma for you and Govind, from Anoop Sharma. What role is social media playing in policy communication? Is social media really the voice of masses, or does the troll take over the message suiting biasing the view? So Govind and Paroma, this is especially for two of you. So you can take this particular question and then...
Please go first.
No, I think there is a lot of distortion in a platform because there is an industrial complex which tends to take over and manipulate. We can see it on some platforms for sure. So therefore, I think, which is not to say the rest of those who use it for good purposes or genuine with good intention do not succeed. But I think the manipulation of platforms is something that we all have to worry about. And it's tough to, have a binary view saying that social media is the voice of the masses. You don't know. I mean, you may have some voices which creep through on some days, which are good and for the good of society, but on many days, it might be something else. So I wouldn't draw a single sort of binary conclusion.
Yeah, I agree with Govind. I don't think that there is, one conclusion that it's either speaking for the masses or they're not. For instance, if you see WhatsApp's incredible growth, obviously, those numbers are not only coming from urban or elite centers only, or the recently banned TikTok. I mean, it's exponential growth too. So in some areas and pockets, they're definitely mass participation. In some, they're not. Twitter may be a lot of, essentially an urban phenomenon. So that's why we absolutely need a framework here. I'm not saying that it needs to be government intervention, but a policy framework which takes cognizance of all these issues and is in a better position to have a judgment or adjudicate or even just provide an opinion. I think there is room for creating something like this.
Thank you, Paroma. Thank you, everyone. I know there are still some questions which were not answered, but conscious of the time, but I'd like to sort of thank you all for being a part of this. I'm gonna invite Anubhuti back to sort of say a word of thanks to the panelists and really sort of, you know, appreciate you having, you know, joining us for, you know, being a part of this, you know, wonderful, complex, but an exciting point of view. And I hope that we can, you know, I think it needs more conversation in the coming months. It's a subject which cannot be completed in about 40, 45 minutes, which we had. But I think the idea was to at least get conversation going, and hopefully in the next couple of months, we will be sort of intending to sort of do more conversation and see if we can come to some kind of a, you know, maybe a framework, as Paroma, you sort of said. So with that, I think, Anubhuti, all yours.
Thanks very much, Aman. Really enjoyed it.
Thank you, Aman.
Thank you.
Aman, and indeed an enlightening and engaging hour, and very well said that this discussion just cannot end in an hour. But I'm sure our learners are going away with tons of learnings today, our attendees. I thank our panelists, Berges, Govind, Paroma, and Sanjay for their time and insights today. Thank you to all our attendees for taking the time out this afternoon. The next edition of Policy Dialogue is scheduled for Friday, 14th of August. Follow us on Twitter, LinkedIn, Facebook, and Instagram at RepTodayMag for speaker and registration details on all the upcoming offerings. See you soon, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Anubhuti, and thank you, Amit and team.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.